Welcome to my series of discussions on aerial photography, aerial imaging, and satellite imagery. This particular section will talk about satellite platforms and imagery. So a few of the topics that I will cover include satellite scanner principles. We'll talk about some high-resolution, mid-resolution, and global satellites, but for the most part, we're going to be talking about how the satellites function, how they collect their data, and then how we can use the data. And along the way, I will include some discussions of particular satellite platforms that deal with high, mid, and global type of imagery. So to begin with, some of our satellite scanner principles. All satellites generally operate on essentially one principle, and the idea is that there's reflected energy coming from the surface of the Earth that's being directed through a series of lasers and mirrors on board a satellite platform. Now, these lenses and mirrors will direct this incoming energy to a sensor array, or an array of sensors. And there's a couple different types of ways that the mirrors and the lenses work. And one method is called the push broom method, and the second method is called the whisk broom method. I'm gonna talk about the whisk broom first because it's kind of going out of fashion and is being replaced by the push broom method. Now, if you can imagine sweeping your floor, you're going back and forth with your broom, right? Well, that's kind of how the whisk broom method works. The mirrors and the lenses wiggle back and forth, and basically what happens is as the satellite passes over the area of interest, basically wiggle back and forth across the direction of travel and gathers information, gathers the incoming radiation off the face of the Earth on a pixel by pixel basis. So the satellite's traversing from left to right on the screen, and then the satellite is basically capturing image on a pixel by pixel basis for each scan here. This is across the track scan. So as it's moving, it'll capture that pixel, then that pixel, then that pixel, and that pixel, and then so it scans this way and moves that way. A couple other things to notice is the instantaneous field of view is what it's capturing at a given moment in time is that cell. The angular field of view is the entire width of the swath, and the swath width is measured across the field at the nadir. The nadir is the point directly above the sensor system, or directly below the sensor system, sorry. The nadir would be about where that tip of that arrow would be. So the other type of sensor, and let me run this video here, and it'll loop, I hope. So the other type of sensor is called the push broom sensor. So rather than have a little wiggling mirror and lens configuration that goes and basically scans back and forth like a push broom, this basically captures the entire width of the swath as the satellite progresses overhead. In the case of this aircraft, because they test these systems on board aircraft first. So as the aircraft or the satellite sensor moves along its orbital path, it's capturing or imaging a swath of the Earth's territory, the Earth's terrain. So it's capturing the field of view. So the field of view is the entire bit, the entire length of or the width of this area underneath the sensor platform. The instantaneous field of view, it's hard to tell in this video, but it's actually capturing little pixels. So with aircraft imagery, the size of the pixels can actually be really small. They can be a centimeter, 2 centimeters, 4 centimeters, 6 centimeters. Whereas with a satellite, satellite's a little bit further out in space, and so the actual ground area that each that's being assigned to each cell is larger, from maybe 30 centimeters all up to, you know, 30 meters. So that's the way this one works. And so we've got this is our satellite platform here. We've got our field of view, which is the width of the swath, and then we have our instantaneous field of view, which is the width of one pixel. So every satellite has an instantaneous field of view, and the instantaneous field of view tends to align with the cell size, and we refer to this as the spatial resolution. So Landsat 8, for example, has a nominal cell size of 30 meters, so its instantaneous field of view is about 30 meters. Now, when you go through and look at the actual flight characteristics of the satellites, these numbers will vary a little bit. On post-processing, most of these values are post-processing before they're given to consumers. It can be some Landsat, early Landsat data was about 28.5 meters for a nominal cell. And what I mean by a nominal cell is it's square. It's 28.5 meters on a side. GOI has a nominal cell size of 41 centimeters. Now, with some of these newer satellites, they can move them farther out in orbit or move them closer. And so as you move closer, the instantaneous field of view will become smaller too. Now that you're closer to your surface, that the geometry of the path has changed a little bit, so you can actually gather higher resolution the closer to your closer to your object that you are. So you'll see on some of these satellite platforms that their instantaneous field of view kind of varies depending on what altitude they're flying at. It also depends on the look angle. Some of these satellite platforms have the ability to look to the side. So we have what we call nadir view, which is directly above our, which is we're looking perpendicular to our surface. But we can have what's called off-nadir view. And off-nadir view is basically when you tilt the sensor array such that you're looking at the surface of the Earth at an angle. So when you do that, when you turn the sensor to look to the side, you get a little bit of foreshortening that happens. And so there's processing in the background that has to eliminate the distortion that you get when you look at look away from your nadir. A little bit of a distortion involved, but that also increases your cell size as well too, because if you think about it, you're actually increasing the distance between your satellite and the ground surface when you look at things that are off nadir. MODIS, the moderate resolution imaging spectroradiometer, has a cell size of 250 meters, 500 meters, and 1,000 meters, depending on what sensor you've decided to look at. And each of those has an instantaneous field of view of 160 meters by 230 meters. So we do have a satellite there that has a nominal cell size, which is not a square. In the image to the right, each cell or each pixel represents a 30 by 30 meter portion of the Earth's surface. In this particular case, we're using a Landsat 5. An image based off of Landsat 5 data. So every satellite has a field of view, and the field of view typically compares to the width of the ground area collected by the sensor platform during a single pass, which is also referred to as a swath. So when you look at the documentation on some of these satellite platforms, they will say the width of the swath is 185 kilometers in the case of Landsat 8. For GOI, the width of the swath is 15.2 kilometers, and for WorldView, the swath is 13.1 kilometers. So not every satellite has exactly the same flight characteristics, flight parameters, and each of them captures an image that is a slightly wider or less wide than another satellite platform. So it kind of works like this. So as a satellite passes over, as it's following its flight path in orbit or around the Earth, and most of these satellites all follow a polar orbits, and so they are flying over the poles. They don't. Some of these satellites, I believe the Chinese have, or they're working on a geosynchronous collection of satellites that are always in space above one spot. But most of these satellites all have a flight characteristics which sends them over the poles. So as it's following this flight path, usually it's from south to north, these satellites are capturing both reflected energy and emitted energy. So a few of these satellites are capable of detecting thermal. So as the energy is being received into the satellite's sensor cone, internal mirrors and lenses are directing this energy onto a pixel on the sensor, or a cell on the sensor. So I tend to use cells and pixels kind of interchangeably. Somebody may get after me about that, but I tend to think of them in essentially kind of the same thing, even though technically they're not, but in some ways you can think about them. A cell is, or a pixel is essentially a portion of one single unit of a grid of data. That's the way I think about it. A satellite can have one CCD, a charge coupled device, or they can have an array of charge coupled devices, because a lot of these satellites have multiple sensors on board. They have sensors for visible light, they have sensors for ultraviolet, they capture different portions of the infrared, the near infrared, the middle infrared. Some of them will capture the far infrared, and then once you get past the far infrared, then you're into thermal. So then you have a separate battery of thermal sensors. And so it's, many of these satellites carry multiple sensors on board. So the way these CCD work is that there's multiple layers on some of these that are sensitive to different portions of the electromagnetic spectrum. So as those wavelengths are passing through, the wavelengths, the way I think about it is this, it's kind of tickling those elemental layers, and then when that tickling process releases ions and releases charges, and so those charges are converted into voltage, and the voltage is then translated into a digital number. And that digital number, you know, for example, with Landsat 5, the digital numbers range from 0 to 255, and so it was 8 bits. We had 8 bits to work with. And so you might have if you had a pale blue, you might, if something reflected lightly in the blue, the digital number may be 80. If it was a kind of, again, a moderate to pale green, or not too reflective in the green, it might be somewhere around an 80. If it was highly reflective in the red part of the spectrum, then it may capture the, it may be assigned 255. It may have generated the highest possible voltage given the sensor. So basically, to reiterate this, so you have a layer within the CCD that gets stimulated by the incoming wavelength of light. It activates a charge that's proportional to the amount of energy that's being received. And so that energy gets translated into a digital number, and then that digital number gets pushed into that, gets assigned to that cell. And then we can use that information to display, to assign a color to that particular pixel. So to go back and read, kind of clean this up a little bit. So what I'm talking about here in terms of the digital number is basically what we refer to as the radiometric resolution. So the digital numbers represent a brightness value, or the strength of incoming radiation. Again, somebody may hammer me on that, but what we're looking at is if something is not reflected very strongly, then the digital numbers are going to be very low. If something is very highly reflective, then we're going to get a lot of reflected energy back, and it's going to have a higher digital number. For example, actively growing green vegetation is going to have a high green value because it's very reflective in the green part of the spectrum. It's also going to be very highly reflective in the infrared part of the spectrum, because green vegetation reflects more infrared energy than it does green. And so I know that it always catches people by surprise, but actively growing, the chlorophyll processing of actively growing plants is highly reflective in the infrared. And so that tells us if it's highly reflecting infrared, it tells us that it's actively growing, gives us some indication of health. So low values are dim, high values are bright. This is referred to as radiometric resolution of the data. Now, the satellite platforms that are designed have different radiometric resolutions. What that means is not everybody shares the same range of values that they will assign brightness levels to. So for example, Landsat 5 had an 8-bit radiometric resolution range. And so 8-bit translates into 256 values. So the way you think about it is this, it's 2 raised to the power of 8. So 2 to the 8th power is 256. So the lowest value we can have is a 0, and the highest value Landsat 5 can have is 255. So all those brightness values for the surface that it was measured, that the satellite would measure, has to fall somewhere within the range of 0 to 255. So things that are really bright, for example, ice, are going to have very high brightness values, 255. Things that are very dark, which is essentially water, because water essentially absorbs most wavelength bands. So it's going to be relatively dark. Landsat 8 has a 12-bit radiometric resolution. So that means 2 to the 12th power is 4096. So 0 is the lowest, 4095 is the highest. After processing, after the data is downloaded and after it's processed, the 12-bit range has been remapped to a 16-bit range with a value of 0 to 65,535. So 16-bit is 2 to the 16th power. And then WorldView 3 has an 11-bit radiometric resolution range, which is 0 to 2047, which is 2048 value. So it's 2 to the 11th. So, okay. All right, to work this out as an example, Landsat 8 has a 12-bit radiometric resolution, 0 to 4095, and then after processing, it has 16-bit radiometric resolution. So if we look at the wavelength that the sensor is sensitive to, 0.64 to 0.67 micrometers, so the sensor's receiving this incoming radiation, it's getting a stimulated electrical response on its sensor array. A weak response, something that does not reflect red very well, might have a digital number of 400. However, if it reflects red really well, it's going to have a fairly high digital number, like maybe 55,000. So Landsat 8 has, it's sensitive to 11 different wavelengths. It captures data, also known as bands or also known as channels. The literature tends to use these terms interchangeably, so pay attention to the context in which the language is being used, because sometimes it's not entirely consistent. But you can tell how they're using things. If they're saying we have 8 bands or 11 bands and we're going to assign them to a particular channel. If they're going to assign them to particular channels, then what they're looking at is the red, green, and blue channels on your display device. So now we have to think about the red, green, and blue pixels on our monitor, and what we're going to do is assign a band from our satellite to a channel, a red channel, a green channel, or to the blue channel for our display device. So we can do that. I mean, so what we have three channels available to us. We have three color guns. So that, to go back in the day, some of you may still have some cathode tube TVs, some tube TVs, right? So that's what I'm talking about, is you had a green gun, a red gun, and a blue gun, and you always knew if one of the guns went out, because then you'd lose a color. And things would look green or blue or yellow or whatever, depending on what gun was lost. Same thing happens on digital monitors, too. If you lose, you can lose some things that are, you can lose a color channel on your monitors too. So basically what we do is now, because of software like ArcGIS Pro or EarthAS Imagine, we can control what wavelengths gets pushed into what color gun on our monitor. So this allows us to take satellite imagery and create like natural color images. Like if we were flying over it in the space shuttle or the International Space Station, we can take that imagery, and by manipulating the software, we can create natural color images. But we can also use the same methodology for taking the portions of the electromagnetic spectrum that we cannot see and making them visible. I mean, we deal with this all the time. Well, maybe not all the time, but when you go to the doctor and your bone's broken, or they think you have pneumonia or something, they're gonna do an X-ray, right? So we do not naturally see X-rays, but we can create materials that once we pass X-rays through our body, we can get those materials to react, and then we can see things we normally could not see. So it's kind of the same principle, and a lot of the same analysis techniques that we use in remote sensing are used in the medical profession. So for example, I'm using ArcGIS Pro, and what I've done here is I've taken three of the bands from Landsat 8, and I have said, okay, I want to display the blue band within the blue channel, I want to display the green band in the green channel, and I want to display the red band in the red channel. So now so what you have to remember is this, is like we have each band is associated with a wavelength. So we have band 5 is near infrared, band 6 is shortwave infrared, we have another shortwave infrared. Panchromatic is basically everything, because we're not separating out colors. We're separating out colors up here. We're just gathering everything. And it's gonna look black and white, because that's what we're doing, is we're not combining these. We're just taking the incoming radiation and assigning. We're basically combining all of those into a brightness value. Cirrus basically looks at clouds. This looks at haze and dust and smoke, coastal aerosols. And then we have two thermal bands. Okay, so we have these different portions of the electromagnetic spectrum, and then we're gonna push those into a color gun on our display device. And when we do that, we have what looks to be a natural color image of Western Kentucky. This is Blood River over here. This is Kentucky Lake. And so we have an image which, you know, if you're 400 miles above, I don't know what the scale of this image is, but actually it's probably not 400 miles. This is probably more like maybe 4 miles. This is what it would kind of look like if you're flying over Murray, Kentucky. But now that we have software that will help us direct the satellite wavelengths into other color guns, we can see other portions of the spectrum, and we can do analysis that way. So now we can change our true color to a false color. So now what I'm doing is I'm taking the blue band and pushing it in the blue. I'm taking the green band and pushing it in the green. But instead of using the red, reflected red, I am using reflected near infrared to go into red. So now I'm using a band combination of 5, 3, and 2. Well, now we can see a whole lot of a different environment going on here. We are limited to red, green, blue, but we can plug in different wavelengths. And one of the things we learn in remote sensing is vegetation is more highly reflective in the infrared. So now we can see what that's actually about, is all this red stuff out here is basically vegetation. So, and the brighter it is, the more actively growing that it is. So some things we can tell now. It's like, so let's look at number one. Number one says the bright blue-gray areas are basically associated with concrete, and these areas are associated with urban areas. So these areas should jump right at us, because they'll help us identify urban areas. We can also see a highway cutting across the middle part of the image,
and then looping up and around the lakes. Two, water is dark because liquid water absorbs infrared energy, thus it doesn't reflect much back much infrared energy. So the infrared bands, the 5, 6, and 7, are all going to be really good to help us differentiate water from non-water areas. If we look at, I think my arrow shifted. So the bright red areas are chlorophyll response of actively growing vegetation. So the bright red square here, these bright red areas here and here. The dark areas are actually trees, and we talk about image for, interpretation. We look at texture, and this looks like a really rough texture, and so that's diagnostic of basically forest cover. We can see a lot of forest cover once we get over towards the lakes as well, too. The dark gray areas, like this one and this one here and some of the ones over here on the left and then the ones above the four, that's bare soil. So you can see how soil looks different than concrete. And so that can help us differentiate agricultural areas from urban areas. So again, what we're doing here is I've created another band combination. This is 4, 6, and 5. The red, the near infrared, and a short wave. I just want to make it clear that when I'm talking about infrared, and people think that infrared is thermal, and it's not. It's just reflected infrared light. It's not thermal. So the idea is you can have reflected infrared, but it's not being emitted from a surface. If it's being emitted from a surface, that's heat. Like you can look at the heat signatures of buildings like manufacturing facilities. So fires, that's emitted energy, whereas the infrared that I'm talking about is basically just the infrared part of the spectrum that's being reflected, that's being generated by the sun, and then it's reflected back to the sensor. There is a complete difference between the two of them. One's reflected energy and one's emitted energy. You know, there's a lot of thermal imaging that goes on these days when you look at insurance and a heat loss, because what we're looking for in heat loss is you're looking at emitted energy, like the heating and cooling units of your home or fireplaces, and to see where heat is escaping. That's thermal energy that's being generated within a structure. So it's important that we get the difference in that down. We can see at one, we have the roof of Pella windows and doors. At two, we have the roof of Walmart. At four, we have the roof of JCPenney's. And I know it's a dark area, but that's also kind of what happens as well, too, is asphalt and the roofs of some buildings, in which I believe this is Lowe's, those are also absorb infrared. And so while things can be highly reflective in the infrared part of the spectrum, red and infrared, they can also absorb. So asphalt often gets confused with water once in a while. To do some other image interpretation here, we can see that there's a road network. We can see a little bit of a linear structure here. We can definitely see a linear structure here. This pattern here, that's a golf course. And we can see another golf course. Let's see. I'm gonna get this right or not. There should be another golf course up here. I don't think that's it though. There is another golf course, it's Sullivan. This is Murray Country Club. But if you begin to look at the imagery over and over again, you can begin to pick some things out. This is a band combination of 7, 6, and 4. This is a short wave infrared, which is the band 6 and band 7, and then plus the red wavelength. So we see a lot of vegetation. It's easy for us to interpret this image in terms of vegetation because we're used to seeing green vegetation. So we can say, aha, green vegetation. We can see some bare ground in the center, lower center, and the lower left of the image. We can see the urban areas kind of pop out as well too, this purpley area. And then again, the water looks blue, but again, the water looks really dark because it's not really reflecting back much in the way of infrared. This band combination is 6, 5, and 2. We have short wave plus near infrared plus blue. The bare soil absorbs moisture as a function of soil moisture, so we can actually get a little bit of response back from the short infrared and the near infrared. And the brightness of the bare soil or the darkness of the bare soil will does depend on the moisture content, because water does absorb infrared energy, and so, but depending on the amount of soil moisture depends on the response. So we see again a really good response back from urban areas. So this is unmistakable urban land use. We can actually see the parking lot at Roy Stewart Stadium. We can also, this is an industrial area as well here. We can also get a little bit of the infield, the AstroTurf of the interior part of the football stadium. And then we also can see some turbidity here too. So there is infrared energy does penetrate water a little bit, and there is a slight return, particularly if the water is going to have a lot of chemicals and or soil or suspended solids. So if a body of water has suspended solids in it, like from agricultural runoff or from an algal bloom, that will show up on satellite imagery. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the planetary coverage of these satellites, because that is an issue. It's not so much of an issue anymore, because most of these satellites now revisit the same area fairly frequently. Landsat 5 and Landsat 8, both of them repeat this coverage about every 16 days. Like, they pass over the same place on the planet about every 16 days. And the satellite crosses the equator at around 10 a.m. Landsat 8 orbits the Earth in a sun synchronous, so that means it's tied with the sun, so it always has illumination, because remember how this works. These satellites gather reflected information, and does nobody any good to have these satellites pass over a dark area of the planet, because it's using the solar illumination to image the surface. So if the sun's not shining on it, the image is going to be dark. It orbits at a altitude of about 438 miles, completes one Earth orbit about every 99 minutes, and has a repeat time of 16 days. Landsat 8 acquires about 740 scenes a day, and to reference these scenes, they use a worldwide reference system. So the WRS, and you basically need to know the path and the row in order to reference the image that you want. You can also, a lot of the applications now these days, you can basically just type in a latitude longitude coordinate of your area of interest, and it will help you figure out what path and row you need. So for example, in Kentucky, I know this graphic is fairly hard to see because it's got a lot of information on it. So you read from left to right and from up, from south to north. So basically, it's hard to see down here at the bottom, but basically we're around path, I think that's around path 24, 25. I know in my notes it says 22. So somewhere, I can't read those numbers very well, but there's 20. So this line right here represents 20. That other red line represents 25. And so 22 is right about in here. And then you can see we cross that red line, and that red line is about, here's 40. So that, and there's 30. So it has to be about 35. So 22, 35 puts us right around in here. And so it takes about 8 to 9 Landsat scenes to cover in Kentucky. And several years ago, I did a project where we did a land cover classification for the entire state.
And I did not cover this in this particular video, but in order to do land cover classification for any area, you basically have to have imagery that's collected when the leaves are on, and you have to have imagery collected when the leaves are off. So that doubles the amount of imagery that you're required to have to do a land cover change, land use change application or project. So in my particular case, I used 18 satellite scenes because that's how many I needed to have that would give me complete coverage of Kentucky. And the also thing you need to have is you need to make sure that there's no clouds present. So just because a satellite captures an image doesn't mean it's going to capture a good image, because if there's clouds covering your area, the energy is not going to penetrate the clouds, either on the incoming or the outgoing portion of the electromagnetic radiation. And so there are some images that are going to be useless because the optical part of the satellite cannot penetrate the clouds, and most of the thermal is going to be useless. So most of the imagery is going to be useless anyway because it's not radar. So it does mean that you're going to have some images that are going to be garbage, because that's just the way it happens sometimes. But like I said, other satellite platforms as well as Landsat 8 can reference imagery by using latitude and longitude, as long as you have one of those from your area of interest. So some of the satellites that are fairly common: Iconos, Quick Bird, GOI, WorldView 1, 2, and 3. There's a few other ones on the next slide that I'll get to. Most of these have so the GSD is your ground sampling distance. So that's basically your cell size or your instantaneous field of view. And this tells you how many kilometers they'll cover in a day. So Iconos has a 1 meter panchromatic sensor and a 4 meter multispectral sensor. And the reason why the resolution goes up is because it takes more data to capture multiple parts of the spectrum than it does the panchromatic, because with panchromatic you're just capturing all the energy coming off of one portion and assigning that a digital value, so it's basically going to be black and white. Whereas with multispectral, you're saying I need to have red, green, blue, and then whatever parts of the usually you're going to get infrared, because ultraviolet doesn't, it's too reflective. So, and then the revisit time is 3 days, which means you can come back to the same spot and take another image 3 days later. So Quick Bird has a ground sampling distance of around 65 centimeters. It has its multispectral resolution is about 2.5 to 2.6 meters. And again, because some of these satellites can be their orbits can change. Like particular government, like if there's a natural disaster, the governments can request better imagery, and so they can move these satellites up and down in orbit. Not a whole lot, but you get some. There's a little bit of leeway. And with Quick Bird, your revisit time can be anywhere from 1 day to about 3.5 days. With GOI, your ground sampling distance is around 42 centimeters. I know my numbers differ from the published numbers, because I just visited the I spent some time looking and investigating these platforms before making this presentation, and some of the data has changed from the image that I'm using in the background. And then for the GOI, the revisit time is 2 to 8, and the reason there's such a wide difference between 2 days and 8 days is because you're able to look off nadir. So some of these satellites they can increase or decrease their altitude while they're in orbit, but they can also turn themselves, and because of the ability to look at off nadir areas, that can give you better revisit time. The image quality is going to go down because again, when you turn it, you're actually increasing the distance between you and the surface of the Earth. That angle is increasing, and so that does lead to higher resolutions. I mean, not higher resolutions, but lower resolutions. So you might go from 1.8 to 2.2, for example. So that begs the question about what your minimum mapping unit needs to be. worldview 1, 2, and 3 all get improved in higher resolution with the newer satellite platforms. And then most of them have a revisit time from anywhere from 1 to 4 to 1 to 6 days because of their ability to be shifted in orbit to look at different things that are off nadir. And then we have other satellite constellations like the Pleiades Neo and the Pleiades 1A and 1B, Vision 1, Spot 6 and 7, the Radar constellation, and the DMC constellation. So you can see one of the things that's interesting is you have a lot of difference in the capacity of being able to store and acquire data, acquire and store. So this is 2 million square kilometers it can gather. So we're talking about a pretty almost global. This is 10 million square kilometers. Or these are some global type, resolution type satellites that you might run across. You can see that the resolutions have decreased to 12 and 24 meters for the DMC. For the radar constellation, it's 25 centimeters to 40 meters. And then we get better resolutions as we get to the Pleiades Neo. So I would recommend going to Satellite Imaging Corp and looking at some of the satellite platform information. It's a pretty cool site. I just clicked the link here. I'll bring it over into my window because it has all sorts of cool information about all these satellite systems. It has images of the day, like I just, you know, the World Islands, Dubai. And if you click on it, actually, let's read the caption. This Worldview 3, which is 40 centimeter resolution, the World Islands of Dubai, was acquired on May 8th, 2020. This section covered by this image is a Europe resort currently under development. This artificial archipelago of smaller islands developed in the shape of the world map. The world islands are composed mainly of sand dredged from Dubai's shallow coastal waters from the Arabian Gulf. So if I click on this, that's not what I want to do, sorry. Let's go back. I thought that would lead me to a higher resolution image. All right, so we have a date, the location, the type of sensor, and the resolution. And I want a better resolution. Well, there is, if you haven't looked at the world islands yet, it's basically a world map made out of islands. So that's the image of the day. There is free archived images that are, it's, you know, pretty cool to download and print out. They make good postcards and bookmarks and things like that. You can get a good example of the types of applications that are useful. Like this one is a image. Here's a full resolution image. All right, this is from a earthquake that happened in the city of Yushu, China, near April 15th of 2010. We can see some haze. I'm not geographically familiar with this area at all, but we can see some haze and some clouds. We have a river, some bridges. Clearly we're in a city district, and clearly we're looking at a bunch of destroyed buildings that were leveled because of the effects of the earthquake. I don't see any other than the leveling of all the buildings and the destruction that's visible. I can't see any surface issues like where roads and things have shifted noticeably based on this image. But again, this might be, in terms of doing this, some of this stuff with West Kentucky, because West Kentucky sits in an earthquake zone, the New Madrid Fault Zone, is this image would be useful for going through and mapping out and looking and assessing how much damage was done in terms of the dollar amount, how many structures were damaged, do a comparison and contrast, how many lives were lost.
and it would help plan the Chinese to help redevelop and rebuild. So this is a nice website with a lot of good information about all the satellites, and I got distracted with that image, and I didn't really, let's see, Worldview 4. On January 7th, 2019, Maxar Technologies, that it's World 4 satellite, oh dang it, I picked a great one. All right, Worldview 3 then. This was launched on August 13th of 2014. So it has sample images. You can download in an image gallery. Sensor specifications, you know that the launch date, what kind of orbit it's in. The altitude, it's in sun synchronous. It's what the expected life expectancy of the satellite is supposed to be. Most of these satellites are going to operate well past their operation service life. Like if it says 10 to 12 years here, there's a good chance it could last longer than 12. It just kind of depends on how it's used and how often it's used and whatnot. But most of these satellites last longer than their estimated service life. If you're interested in what their power is, their size or mass, their sensor bands are listed. This one's interesting because it has 12 bands. It collects wavelengths that are sensitive to desert clouds, aerosol levels in the atmosphere, different water bands. The multispectral has red edge. So red edge is right there on the fringe between red and infrared. There's a yellow, there's a near infrared, and a near IR infrared 2. And usually it'll give you what the spectral resolution is for some of these too. So that's really kind of good, because that gives you, if you're interested in these kind of applications, and this is why people don't really grasp how we're able to know about things like climate change or what's happening in the atmosphere, is because there's scientists out there that are looking for specific things in the atmosphere, like these aerosol levels and such. And so those give us the details that we need to make the decisions that we make. And so I get a lot of questions a lot of the time about, well, how do you know these things? And I'm like, well, I may particularly not know them. However, I know the satellite. I know the scientists out there that are building the satellites that gather the data and study and analyze these issues, and then I read their results, and so that's kind of how I know. I'm not doing the actual work, but I'm reading the results of the people that are doing the actual work. So that's how I know. And that's how they know, is because we're building these cool devices and putting them above our planet so that we can study what's happening. So we have the different kind of platform characteristics here about what the sensor resolution is, the ground sample distance. You have the nadir is the point directly above the planet where the satellite is gathering the data. The dynamic range is again the radiometric resolution. It says we're getting 11 bits per pixel in the pan and the multispectral. And then there's a shortwave infrared, which is getting 14 bits. And there's some other, I'm not going to read all, go down through all this. It can tell you retargeting agility. It can tell you how accurate things are, the swath width, what kind of communications it's kind of using. It doesn't give you the exact details about the hardware, but where did I see? Oh, it has a 2,000 or 2,200 gigabyte solid state EDAC drive. And so I'd have to look up EDAC to see what EDAC meant. So those are all kind of some cool things that are readily available. For learning about the satellite system, and then you can determine what kind of satellite system best suits your project or your needs. And then there's a list of ones over on the side too, which is interesting to read about those. All right, thank you for listening and watching. I appreciate it. Thank you.